Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Good evening, I'm Christian Esguera, and welcome to this episode of After the Fact, where we get to see things more clearly, where we get a better sense of the truth. So let's start by dissecting the news. President Rodrigo Duterte has announced that he will indeed run for president a decision his PDP Laban party described as a sacrifice. But here's the catch. The president said something else which was removed when Malacanang aired his taped address on Tuesday night. Out of, quote, delicadeza, Duterte claimed he won't run if his daughter Sara would also seek the presidency. This means his longtime aide and now Senator Christopher Go will not gun for the presidency as well. Now here's where it becomes even more interesting. Mayor Sara Duterte later issued a statement telling her father to stop using her supposed candidacy as a reason for him to run or not to run. But first, let's get this straight. Can an outgoing president run for vice president in the next election? What does the Constitution say? Joining us tonight is attorney Christian Monsod. He's a member of the 1986 Constitutional Commission, which crafted the 1987 Constitution. Later in the program, we will be joined by the spokesman of Mayor Sara Duterte to talk about her stunning rebuke of the president and his party mates in a statement she issued earlier today. Now, be part of our discussion. Send us your questions and comments on our YouTube live chat or tweet us using the hashtag ANCAfterTheFact. Good evening, Attorney Monsod, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, as an additional introduction for you, you are also the chairman of the Commission on Elections, and you are now the convener of a nonpartisan group called Coalition Election 2022. Okay, you're promoting voter registration and voter and education as well. Okay, let's go straight to the point. Can President Duterte run for vice president? Is this allowed by the Constitution?
Well, my position is that is that this is an insidious and blatant move to circumvent the Constitution and its prohibition on re-election. Because one, the vice president is in the mandatory line of succession to a vacancy that can be created for a self-serving purpose. And number two, the term limits in the Constitution is a social justice provision. And there is also the anti-dynasty principle in case it is a daughter-father team. Why the ban on re-election for the president? One cannot look only at one provision. When you look at an issue like this, you have to take at the take the Constitution as a whole and look at what is the constitutional design for the office of the president and, for that matter, for elective offices. During the deliberations of the Constitutional Commission, the six-year term without an election was a compromise with the previous 4 years plus another 4 years of re-election. The rationale was that 6 years is enough time for a good president, and on the other hand, can prevent a bad one from using his vast powers to continue in office. So a president has 6 years, the vice president has maximum 12 years, senators only two consecutive terms of 6 years, and congressmen and local government officials a maximum of three consecutive terms of 3 years each, and elections every three and no longer every 2 years.
Okay, but in this case, I just like to point to the specific provision in the Constitution. Isn't this clear? Because it's also the one being pointed to by those who are espousing the other side of the debate, claiming that the Constitution is at the very least silent regarding the president can run. So ergo, President Duterte can indeed run for vice president next year, specifically because of this part of the provision. The president shall not be eligible for any re-election. So their interpretation is that this is limited to running for president again.
Yes, as I said, you have to take a look at the entire Constitution. And that's why I gave you what were the deliberations all about. And people might want to look at the reasons why that any re-election prohibition went there. And they should read what Padilla, former Senator Padilla, who espoused that provision, said about it. Now, so what I'm saying is the whole of the Constitution, there is a constitutional design to allow a president to run as vice president, would open a back door to the office even longer than the replaced provision of a maximum of 8 years. And And each president can now use the vast powers of the presidency to serve for 12 years. That is not the intent of the Constitution. If you read the rest of the provision, you'll notice there is only one exception to anybody occupying the office of the president more than 6 years. That is a vice president who was succeeded to the presidency and had served for less than 4 years. Okay. Therefore, like Arroyo, she served for 10 years. And the exception proves the rule. So when you interpret that provision, you must interpret it as also including a prohibition on occupying the office of the president for more than 6 years.
Okay, but if the intent was clear as far as the deliberations were concerned, and if you're going to read the rest of the provisions or the Constitution in its entirety, why didn't the framers actually make that very, very specific that the president cannot seek the vice presidency after?
Well, I think if you look at the deliberations, there is an assumption that nobody would try it, because the intent of the Constitution and the spirit of the constitutional design is that you can have only 6 years. We are a country of 100 million people. And if you open that back door, every president from now on will aspire for 12 years. And that destroys the design of the Constitution on social justice, of diffusing wealth and political power for the common good, and addressing the social, economic, and political inequalities in our country. And the heart of our Constitution is social justice. That's the heart of our Constitution.
But at the same time, was this something that the framers, including yourself, did not anticipate during the deliberations in 1986, that eventually something like this could happen?
Yeah, I think if you read the deliberations, it was understood all the way, by the way that Padilla and others, right? In fact, Chief Justice David is one of the proponents of that provision on no re-election and so on. The spirit and intent is really to limit sitting in the office for more than the term of 6 years.
Okay. So the ban clearly is to run again for president and vice president, but other than that, the president can seek any other position, elective position.
Well, as Arroyo did, she went back to Congress. There is no prohibition on that, but the presidency is one position out of, of what, something like hundreds of thousands of positions in government with a 6-year term with vast powers. You have to look at it from that way. It is part of the system of checks and balances.
Earlier, I was listening to one interview of an election lawyer, and his position is that the constitutional provision is silent, so that for him, President Duterte can run in 2022 for vice president, because he made the distinction between succession or assuming the presidency by election and by succession. You were talking about a backdoor. So again, can this also be used as an argument that this was somehow overlooked by the framers, so that in case that happens, but you don't want the president to stay in office for more than 6 years because that is the limit, but if he ends up winning the vice presidency and something happens to the president, he automatically assumes the post, and that, according to you, would defeat the purpose of the 6-year ban. But then again, hindi ba to gray area? Yung assuming the presidency by succession.
Okay, in this case. There is no way to resolve this. Eventually, it's the Supreme Court. First, it goes to the Commission on Elections as soon as it files for certificate of candidacy, and then it will go to the Supreme Court. And I don't think the Supreme Court will avoid ruling on this one the way they did in the case of Estrada. Hmm. Where the deliberations took so long, and then the elections came, and then afterwards they said that it is moot and academic. In other words, they didn't rule on it.
Okay. Ano lang, let's refresh the memory of our viewers. You were referring to 2010, right?
Correct.
When former President Joseph Estrada ran again for president after he first won in 1998, but he was unseated because of EDSA 2 in 2001. So the COMELEC did not exactly rule on that, right?
No. The COMELEC said, allowed it. Remember, he was able to run. Allowed it on the ground that he did not finish his term. That assumes, implies, the six-year limit as well.
Mm-hmm. Right? But what would have been the correct interpretation of that in that specific case of Joseph Estrada? He was not able to finish his term, right? Less than 3 years pa lang, natanggal na siya.
How I would interpret it is this. The Constitution talks about any re-election. So I asked my friend in the COMELEC who said that he did not finish his term. And I said, what would you call him if he was elected president? Wouldn't you call him a re-elected president? Right?
What would be the answer? Technically, he was re-elected because he was elected for a second time, right?
If he won.
Yeah, if he won.
Yes. That's why I said that the COMELEC interpretation was wrong. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court did not rule on it on the ground that it had become voter academic.
Because in the first place, he had lost.
Yeah, that's what the Supreme Court said.
But in this case, what do you think are the options in this interesting case of President Duterte? Again, assuming that he indeed files a COC and not substituted by anyone, that he indeed proceeds to running for vice president. Can't this be also somehow decided in such a way that it would just be left to the voters, to the sovereign will of the people, to make that decision?
Well, that's like the argument of Puno in the case of Sigaw ng Bayan on the initiative of Arroyo to change the constitution. And that's the argument. But ultimately, it's a sovereign will of the people. But remember that it's a sovereign will of the people that approved this constitution with its limitations, 76% vote in the plebiscite for the 1987 constitution. So which sovereign will? What sovereign will are you talking about when the basic law of the land, the intent and the constitutional design says or means that he cannot run for vice president?
Okay. So as far as the framers are concerned, as far as the constitutional provision is concerned, as far as the deliberations in 1986 were concerned, the provision is clear. Duterte cannot run for vice president. The provision is clear.
Yes. To us, the intent of the constitution is clear. As I said, you cannot read it in terms only of one provision.
Okay.
But you look at it from the whole construct and the constitution as a whole.
Okay. Now let's talk about the implications of this. Again, we have to discuss these possibilities with the idea that the president could change his tune again. Because remember, when he first said, when it was first reported, based on his taped public address, that he would indeed run for vice president, apparently there was a portion of that public address that was taken out, that was removed. That was quite interesting because this happened in Malacañang.
They always do that. They always, when he makes a mistake, when he's ascribed to him, then they correct themselves. That's not.
Pero dito, this is very interesting because that portion that was removed can be seen to actually benefit one party to the detriment of another. Kasi yung tinanggal na portion doon was that the president actually saying that his vice presidential run would be conditioned on whether Sara Duterte would run for president. Which explained the strongly worded and perhaps acerbic statement coming from the daughter. I mean, what do you make of that?
Can I just say, I think it's unfortunate of the president to say that. Because if I were an ordinary, we ordinary Filipinos would say, teka muna, parang inaangkin nila yung bayan natin na sila lang ang may-ari kasi nag-uusapan lang yung magpapalitan sila ng anak niya mag-presidente. Parang ganon, di ba? So sa akin, may pagkakamali yun. But I think the president will not run for vice president.
Why? Why do you think so?
Because I think he knows that that's a lot of, what you put it, absurd legalism. He knows what the intent is. He's a lawyer. And he knows, reading the constitution as a whole, what the intent is.
Hmm. And of course, you can also point to previous pronouncements coming from the president. He had been saying repeatedly that he's tired, that he wanted to resign. Then all of a sudden, he would say, I accept the nomination by PDP Laban to run for vice president.
I think it's a question of, he's a bit desperate. Desperate that he's running out of options. Because everybody wants to keep power. Right? And everybody wants to avoid accountability. And in his case, I think he's especially afraid of that accountability, because he also said that one of the reasons he might consider running is because of the immunity, right? He said immunity from suit of a president. You remember that? I mean, you can look at the record, and he said that that's one, you know, he was concerned about that. And then therefore he might run because the president is immune from suit. Well, okay. The bank president is not immune from suit.
Yes, precisely.
So the purpose of running for vice president is to be president, to succeed himself. Very clear.
Okay, that is very interesting. But again, I'd like to challenge that proposition as well, because can you actually control that situation when you already talk about the presidency? I mean, this is not Davao City. You cannot just flick certain options for the mayoral position or the vice mayoral position. I mean, if you put somebody there as president and he or she gets elected, who knows? Once you feel the power of the presidency, all bets might end up being off. Don't you think?
Yes. Okay. That's why it's also interesting. But the Kusi PDP Laban said that he can choose who's going to be president if he runs for vice president. That's unusual, isn't it? In practice, that's very unusual. So that's one. He says, you choose. And the mention is only two. Either his daughter or Bongo, correct?
Yeah.
So the purpose of all this is to stay in power. And that's why it's insidious and it's too blatant. And I think he knows that, you know, if you look at the history of proposals for charter change, the one the people don't like the most is when it's self-serving to stay in power, right? Yeah. Irma, for example, of Ramos, Sion ng Bayan of Arroyo, and the other provisions of the constitution, when it comes to staying in power beyond the term provided in the constitution and its prohibitions and intent, the people don't like that. And I think the president knows that. And that's why I don't think he's going to run.
Okay. How do you reconcile that? You don't think the president is going to run, but at the same time, he wants to stay in power through the vice presidency?
Yes, because as I said, he also wants to avoid accountability, right?
Hang on, why yung tumakbo? Paano siya magiging vice president and assume the presidency by succession?
What do you mean? We're back to that same thing, right?
Yeah.
We're going around the same issue of whether you look at it from the point of view of one provision that there is no...
My question, Attorney Munson, is this. If you don't believe that the president is going to run for vice president, but you think that he wants to stay in power as president, pero dahil term limited siya, dadaan siya sa vice presidency. Paano siya makakarating dun kung ayaw niya tumakbo in the first place, according to you?
Well, we're talking about the options. The options of power and the options of accountability, right? Even before even while mayor, President Duterte said that he wants to change the constitution by establishing a revolutionary government. The RevGov, correct?
Yeah.
That's out of the equation now, because the military and the Defense Department have said that a revolutionary government, which by the way is similar to Marcos's revolution from the center, that a RevGov is outside the four corners of the Constitution. So that's out. Second, is charter change. And the president himself in 2018 and 19 said that it will not happen during his term, that it's for future administrations to do. It's dead in the water. That's the second option.
Okay.
The third option is the Anti-Terrorism Act. That's the proxy for martial law forever, because that only can mean that he may be able to establish a constitutional authoritarianism, right?
Mm.
There are certain purposes for this move now to say he's willing to run for vice president, and he's looking for a hole. He's looking for a backdoor, because the ones that are that may explicitly could have been done are out, are off the books, right? Off the table. Rebel, charter change, anti-terrorism is still before the Supreme Court.
Mm.
So the key to all this, when you look at it that way, the key to all this is the Supreme Court.
Okay. But don't you think, given his track record in 2015, yung style na kunwari hindi tatakbo pero tatakbo pala, and all these strategies that were employed in local politics, don't you think they're quite obvious to read, especially in this day and age?
Yeah, well you know, the Dutertes like to play that game, and the daughter is behaving exactly like the father before 2016. It puts them in the headlines, puts them at not greedy for power and only answering the call of the people. It's a favorite gambit by the Dutertes.
Okay. I'd like to talk about your advocacy, the coalition election 2022. Part of the advocacy is not just to encourage people to register and vote, but also to do some voter education, right? So given what's happening now, You hear the president saying that he's now open, or he will actually run for vice president. You see that from the other side, whether you can consider that as the other side, the prospect of the daughter running for the presidency is there. The option of Senator Bongo as the standard bearer of PDP Laban. With everything that's happening, what do you think are the most important issues or aspects of our electoral system and political system as well that you need to focus on in terms of educating voters?
Well, I think a lot of people have concerns and are uncomfortable about certain things happening in the COMELEC. But up to today, the COMELEC has behaved impartially. Of course, there'll be a change in February, and there'll be four new commissioners, including the chairman. But I think the COMELEC, you see, the COMELEC is more than just the seven commissioners. In fact, it's more than just the COMELEC, including 5,500 COMELEC employees. Yeah? Elections is about all of us participating. But so what's important is to take a look at what are the safeguards against manipulating the automated system. And there are many. There are many. But you know what? The reason why I'm concerned is that if you look at the history of the people on their responsibilities as safeguards against cheating in elections, for example, the source code review, for example, the random manual audit, right? All of these are safeguards against a wholesale cheating at the polls. We're not afraid of retail cheating. We're afraid of wholesale cheating. And there are safeguards. And the COMELEC, I think, will be impartial, because the great majority of the bureaucracy of the COMELEC are very good people who want to do their job. And I think we proved that in 1992, that when given the chance, the COMELEC responds at the ground level. And that's where elections are made or unmade, is at the ground level.
Despite the supposed popularity of the current president, you still think that the COMELEC's people would stick to that?
Yes, of course. I mean, there is no connection. If the people still vote for the candidate of President Duterte, then the sovereign will must be accepted. Mm. But we must make sure that the process is free, fair, and, you know, a free and fair elections, correct? And that's up to us. That's why you have a NAMFREL, you have a LEPE, you have a PPCRV, you have NGOs, and we have our coalition for the coalition election 2022, because we're going to go through this process of making sure the safeguards are done by the people. Okay. All right.
Finally, Attorney Monsod, what do you think should the voters really focus on in identifying prospective candidates, going through their track records? What they think are the most important things that they should focus on in selecting the next president? Let's be specific for that, on that, the next president.
Let's put it this way. I think that what is important to the ordinary people are whether their daily struggles for survival are being addressed or can be addressed, right? What are these? Criminality, drugs, delivery of government services, corruption, even traffic, right? These are the inconveniences of the general public. And this is not about abstract things, about equality and so on. This is about their daily struggle. So they have to look at the leaders who can address primarily the daily struggles, the problems of daily struggles. Secondly, I think that from the point of view of the people, they have enough sense of what's going on. Look at the 2019 elections. Many entrenched political dynasties lost, correct? And if you look at that, also many young incorruptible officials were elected, especially at the local level. So what happens at the local level is very, very important. In fact, I think there are two elections in our country, the national and the local, and then there is the barangay. Those elections are more important to the ordinary people than a president or senators, because they affect their lives. Now, the other point is that the pandemic showed us something that we didn't really think would happen in that manner. It's the way that the people at the ground engaged in humanity acts to help those in need, right? Yeah. The community pantries, for example. Mm. People, in other words, they're doing it at the ground level. And that's where the change should come. Okay. Because these are social changes. The social changes, in other words, the social transformations at the ground is more important than who's elected president. Sinergia on education, for example, just one more point. Yeah. 496 municipalities. What is that? The barangay and the teachers and the parents work together to improve the quality of the education of their children. And those parents who had more education than many others, because only 70% of the parents of the poor finish elementary, parents are helping parents. Right, so that's what's happening at the ground, and we should nurture and push for that happening on the ground if we want real change.
Before I let you go, there's a question for you, Attorney Monsod. What do you think about a Duterte backers company winning the COMELEC contract for the deployment of election equipment and materials?
I would give the benefit of the doubt to the COMELEC on this one, because apparently the companies have already provided in two other elections logistics services. So it a relatively good record. There was nothing that they did that was out of order. So I would give the COMELEC the benefit of the doubt, but we should also watch it. Because the people's organizations should monitor what's happening, whether the materials have been delivered on time, and so on and so forth. So it's the source code, random manual audit, and the monitoring of citizens and people's organizations.
Okay. Attorney Christian Monsod, thank you for joining us this evening.
You're welcome.
Now we're going to take a quick break. After the fact, we'll be right back. Oh,
We visit two watersheds in the province of Aurora, the Amro River Protected Landscape and the Talaytay Protected Landscape. The rivers are the lifeblood of communities sustaining their needs and the biodiversity in the area.
In this episode, we demystify the world of wine for you and break down in visual detail how wines are made. The key wine terms to remember. The important wine regions of the world. Plus the basics of wine appreciation and food pairing.
The biggest news. The most compelling stories and issues that matter to you. Top Story, Monday to Saturday at 5 p.m. here on ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods.
Welcome back to After the Fact. Joining us now is former Camarines Sur Congressman Rolando Andaya Jr., who is now speaking for Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte Carpio. Good evening, Congressman, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Yes, good evening, Christian, and good evening to our viewers.
Okay, first, help us understand what's happening between the daughter and the father. We saw the statement coming from the daughter, Davao City Mayor Sara Duterte, and by the looks of it, she was quite incensed with these statements coming from her father. Is this really the case?
Well, on my part, I'm not surprised. And if I can give a shout out to Inday Sara, you go, girl.
Just pero talaga bang galit siya?
Well, unang-una, kitang-kita mo yung pagkatao niya rito. She announced her arrival in the national political arena. Unang-una ro, kitang-kita mo yung paggalang na binigay niya sa kanyang ina. She asked, she begged for an apology sa mom niya for doing what she's doing now. Actually, in effect, what she did was to break all the misconceptions that people have against her. That she would be, you know, susunod-sunuran lang sa kanyang ama, that she will just continue what her dad or the track record of that administration of her father has done. She's a different person, just as I've told you in your first our first interview, exactly what I told you will happen. She will not follow or obey or give any concessions to any party. We've seen over the past weeks or months, national parties trying to woo her in. No deal. Now the biggest party, the PDP Laban, no deal pa rin. Just as I've said, she will do this independently. She would want to choose her vice president on her own. Walang makakapagdikta sa kanya.
Okay.
She is a Duterte, but she is a better version. Na ano to? Kalahati niya is Zimmerman. You can see
yes. You're giving us a preview of the kind of presidential campaign that she was she's going to run. Anyway, bago yung Congressman Nonoy, pag-usapan muna natin. Sabi niyo this is the real Sara, no? She announced her arrival. That's your pitch.
Just like the pitch I made last time.
Yeah, pero on the other hand, this can also be seen as a script. Hindi naman kayo scripted ito. To put the spotlight on Sara Duterte and to achieve precisely that. That the president indeed is not exactly or not is not really planning to run for vice president, but to just make things more interesting and in the end actually prepare everything for the daughter.
No. Kitang-kita mo rito yung moralidad at yung pundasyon niya sa pagiging tao galing sa nanay niya. Doon mo nakikita yon. And with that kind of a moral foundation, I don't see her using a family squabble o sisirain mo yung ama mo publicly just to gain the presidency. Hindi siya ganun. Malayo-malayo sa ugali niya.
So yes. Ito, reflection to ng Zimmerman side niya?
Yes, yes. Yung religious side, the strong family ties nila. Admittedly, kung anong manangyari sa pamilyan nila, that's not the doing of Sara. It was a different decision made long time ago by the president. Wala namang kasalanan si Sara ron. She's just moving forward.
Let me follow up on that. In case people might misconstrue what you said, no? Sabi niyo, this is the one half Duterte, one half Zimmerman. He mentioned the word moral, and then this is the mother side, no? By consequence, are you saying that the father side isn't?
No, that's what I was explaining before you cut me off. He had his own reasons why it happened. And what the daughter can do is just move forward, learn from the lessons she's gone through in life. It appears that the mother has a strong moral suasion upon her, and she's moving forward. And she does not appreciate or she detests the fact that she's being used or she's being forced to come to a decision whether she's running or not, and at the same time be forced to fall under a particular political party. Ayaw niya yun. And she's kept quiet all this time. Till now, her concern is all about COVID. It's all about saving Davao City. But it just so happened na talagang umabot na sa sukdulan. And she had to speak out. Ano sa kanya, we all understand that it's a no-win situation for her when it comes to convincing the opposition. She doesn't say anything, she's following her father. She doesn't, when she goes against the wishes of the National Party, she's now playing a script. So it's a no-win situation for her when it comes to trying to convince the political opposition. That's normal.
Okay.
And she's accepted that fact and she will move forward learning from all of these experiences she's going through right now.
Okay. There's another word, interesting word that you used.
Yes.
Used. Do you think the president is trying to use her?
No. The party is trying to use her. You know, the president, yes, the president, as you've seen, the president only comes in at an end or towards the end of a squabble. Remember that Manny Pacquiao issue? He never was part of it. And then when they endorsed him, that's when he comes in. It just so happens, hindi naman si President Digong nagdidesisyon na papatakbo ng partido. It's not him. And that's quite obvious. And it's just gotten to the point na pati yung dad niya, nagamit na as a possible vice presidential candidate. You know, that was meant to force her out, whether to give up because your father's so purportedly running for vice president, so you just rather give up. They never thought that she would actually go against that kind of a proposal, which she actually did. So now the president is put in this situation, but I think it works for the personal concern of the president. Okay. Now
let me challenge you on that. When you said the president is not the one using the daughter, but the political party PDP Laban.
Yes, that's I assume
you are referring to the Kusi faction. Is that correct?
Whatever faction you talk about, I look at this one party. You know, that's an internal thing that they have to decide upon themselves.
But let me challenge you on that. When you said that even the president had nothing to do with what's happening with the party. Number one, he's the party chairman. And it's not exactly correct to say that he only came after he was nominated. Kasi even before this happened, binabanatan
na even in the corporate world, the chairman doesn't handle the day-to-day. It's the same thing in a political party. They just give the direction, the general direction, but on the decisions on these matters, obviously, even in the corporate world, a chairman does not handle the day-to-day affairs.
Oh, pero can you say that he was not an active participant in this squabble? Because he was also attacking Manny Pacquiao, and this was the timing of which was quite interesting during the height of the attacks of the Kusi faction against the Pacquiao faction. So can you honestly say that the president was not an active player in this?
If he was an active player, a day-to-day operations kind of guy, that Pacquiao faction and that Kusi faction never would have happened with this kind of personality. Sisimula pa lang yung gulo na yan, wala na yan. Obviously, He is the chairman and he doesn't get to see or participate in day-to-day affairs.
But on the other hand, the president is also, of course, is often described as a lawyer. No? He's not exactly a fool, di ba? Sabi nga nila, he's bright.
Of course not.
So why would he allow himself to be used by his own party to actually stave off a possible challenge from his own daughter?
You know, if he would do the day-to-day operations of the party, he won't be able to do his job as president. So you have to separate yourself. His job is 24/7 as president. For him to get himself involved in intra-party politics, that will just simply exhaust him and he will not be able to do his job. Eh, ito na nga eh, yung pagka-presidente niya, batikos inaabot mo araw-araw, makikigulo ka pa dyan sa intra-party politics. So, I really don't see him participating in that kind of a minute detail.
Eh nga, pero kung hindi siya nakikialam sa intra-party squabble, why did he in the first place say that he was accepting the nomination and that he would run for vice president?
That is what I was getting at a while ago when I said that plays to his personal advantage. Because in the end, I feel that he knows that Sara will decide whether with his blessing or not, she will have to decide one of these days whether she will run or not. And she will. And now he wants to protect her as a father, that she will have a free hand on who she will choose as vice president. Because had she taken that route of PDP, I'm sure magiging vice president niya would be either Senator Go or somebody else na hindi siya komportable. Now this part, that is no longer playing politics. He's playing as the father. Now he's concerned that his daughter might end up choosing or being forced to choose or have a political marriage with someone that she does not trust or she's not comfortable with. That's where he's coming from.
Okay, pero this is the first part ng statement ni Mayor Sara Duterte. Sinabi niya, unpleasant event yung conversation niya with her father, di ba? Kasi dalawa rin options na binibigay sa kanya. Two endorsement letters. One is to endorse, was to endorse a Go Duterte tandem. And number two, tanggapin niya si Bongo as her vice presidential candidate.
Ayaw niya.
So, rejected na to, pareho.
Of course, out the window pareho yan. Out the window pareho yan. And if I were the father, I would do this, what I said. I'll give you the free hand. The vice presidency is focused on President Digong now. Who would even dare challenge him as vice president? No one. But we all know, I'm also a lawyer, that's an insane proposition that the president will run for vice president. Tama si Mr. Monson. He's correct. Hindi pwede yun. Digong is a lawyer and he knows that. But it just so happened it was forced upon him by the party. Oh, you run for vice president. Yeah, sure, I'll take it to protect my daughter and not for me to actually run as vice president. He knows that. He will not do that. He's just too wise and wily for the opposition to understand him.
So, yeah, let's elaborate on that. How exactly will his acceptance of that nomination help the daughter?
Sa simpleng salita, sino papalag sa kanya as vice president? Assuming he pursues. Sino?
So, aatras yung iba?
Of course, sino pa ba gustong lumaban sa kanya? No one. Assuming that he will really do it. But he won't. Because he's a lawyer. We all know that's crazy. But you know, there are some even crazier people who will propose such a thing. So sinakyan na lang yan. But in reality, if he does that, walang papalag. And no one will even dare, you know, propose that I take your place. He is giving Sara the free hand to choose who she wants to be her running mate.
Okay, another interesting part ng statement is Sara Duterte, yung last part, number four, item number four. Sabi niya, I am not a last 2 minutes person. I think I organize and I implement accordingly. In this case, is she actually preparing for a presidential run? Sabi niya, she's not a last 2 minutes person.
Alam mo, what she's saying to all of these political parties is, I'm not playing ball with you. I'm not about to go into your court. You want to help me? You get into my court. You come to me. I don't come to you. I dictate what will happen, not you impose conditions upon me. That's all she's saying. Now, whether she's running or not, I think she is. Does she have the organization? Yes, she does. Does it have the blessing of the father? Maybe. but she has it on her own, even she does it by herself. Kaya niya. Kaya niya to. And of course, the father will never allow her daughter to lose. Kahit na anong sabi mo, between your daughter and a political party, I think very obvious naman yung decision niya.
Okay, so Sara Duterte is preparing for a presidential run. Naghahanda siya.
Well, the way I look at it, I've been going around the country. I've been in my district. I'm in my province. I see it. I see people coming up to me and volunteering to join the Sara for presidency. I never came to them. I actually stopped talking about it. But they're the ones looking for me. So I guess she's gaining support. So,
okay. So
if I were her and I've already declared my independence, yes, I would pursue it.
So in this case, which national party would carry her candidacy?
Just like I told you, wala. She will run as an independent. Now, if other parties like Lakas or Nacionalista would like to adopt her, she will welcome it. But for her to seek their support and be subjected to, you know, conditions, decisions she will make now, even before she's elected, she will not allow that to happen. She has seen it happen to her father. Na hindi pa nga tapos yung, hindi pa nga umiinit yung upuan niya as president. There have been secretaries who have been pre-selected already by different parties. She will never allow that to happen.
In your case, are you open to assuming another cabinet post under Duterte administration?
Of course not. I'm running in my little district.
Eh, pero pag in-invite kayo, let's say manalo kayo, hindi in-invite kayo.
Mahirap sabihin yan. Manalo muna ako. Eh, paano ko matalo?
At manalo muna siya.
Manalo muna. Yan nga. Let's see first.
Okay. So, are we seeing a situation, this kind of situation? Sabi niyo, Sara Duterte is basically open for adoption ng mga political parties, no? So, are you seeing a situation where several parties would endorse her as a common candidate, no? But technically, she's going to run as an independent.
Which she has. So, yung, of course, that's her local party.
That's a regional party, eh?
Yeah, it's a regional party. So, that will always be a regional party. Doon siya pinakamalapit sa lahat, and we had so many national parties trying to form a coalition with Humpong and nothing happened. No signing ceremony happened. You know why? Because there were so many conditions being asked by these parties. So Sara just said, forget it. I don't need it.
Wait, ilalawin ko lang. Ang sinasabi nyo, despite the pronouncements of several parties
nothing not long ago,
walang napirmahan.
Ni isa wala. Because there were so many conditions attached to it.
What conditions? For example, Lakas. Anong condition ng Lakas?
You know, the conditions will all be the same. We want this cabinet position. We want this position. We want this and that. She doesn't want that. She wants to be given the free hand to choose. Kung sino tingin niyan tama, she will choose that.
So far, she has no alliances with any of the political parties aside from Mugpong.
Wala.
Not even NUP?
No.
Okay.
None. So, those are many misconceptions. Walang alliance. She is, at this point in time, an independent, and she will continue to be independent and independently minded. There are some things which are really non-negotiable to her. Una-una, the vice presidency. That is non-negotiable. You cannot force upon her in person, hindi niya kilala, hindi siya komportable. She will insist that she will choose the right person for her. So, doon pa lang, yung mga partido lumalapit sa kanya, doon pa lang nagkakagulo niya. Stonewall ka agad. That's why we don't see any signing or any ceremony of any particular national party hooking up with Humpong.
Before we end, can you cite at least a few names na inilalako sa kanya ilang parties for her vice president?
Lahat naman nung nakita mo mga names in the past months. You know, you have Martin Romualdez, you have Bongbong Marcos, you have Senator Go. There are so many names being floated around. And those were being shall we say, brought to her by their parties, which is quite natural. It happens. It happens every election, even happens in the local elections. But this time around, she has, from her experience in her father's presidency, she in her mind feels that that is not the right way to go. That she can probably do a better job if she's given the persons on the right persons to do the right job for her in her administration.
Okay. Former Congressman Nonoy Andaya, thank you for joining us tonight, sir.
Thank you.
So that's it for tonight. This has been your host, Christian Esguerra. You can watch this episode again on iWantTFC or listen to our podcast on Spotify. Now, for recaps and other exclusive content, subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel and catch up with us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. See you again tomorrow after the fact.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.